Hey everybody, we sure hope you're enjoying following along with Lizzy Albright, and Kat and I have certainly had fun putting this whole idea together. If you have not been aware, we did a quilt reveal, and so now we're going to add the quilt reveal to the opening of this. So this is the Lizzy Albright quilt that that Granny made. That it's in the cedar chest in the attic. 42 blocks, 8-inch blocks with attic window setting and flying geese borders. And the flying geese, of course, have those 9 patches in there. So we have had a lot of fun with this. And this is the quilt that I designed the fabrics for that are described in Chapter 7, and also the blocks that are described in Chapter 7. And I thought I might show you this because this is the cover of the book. And the cover of the book is the quilt is sitting on the mansion that's actually a real mansion in Kansas, and that is the attic window that we imagine whenever Lizzy is flying out through it. So we will be able to have not only the novel that you're listening to that shows this house on the front cover, but also the Lizzy Albright sampler quilt that you can make with your family. You can make it with your grandkids. It's all pretty exciting. So yay! So Kat, thanks for the inspiration, because you were the one that inspired it all.
So if you haven't watched that other video that we did of the quilt reveal, it was such a blast. It's about 45 minutes long, so it's really, but it's worth it every minute, and you'll get to see the whole thing. So for those of you who are just listening to the story, which we love and adore, please be sure to go over and check out the quilt reveal.
I will put a link at the bottom in the comments here, or the description, so that people can click through to that. But you're right, it is now on to Chapter number 23.
Chapter 23.
Yeah. Yay. I hear wedding bells.
Yeah. I hear music of the law on there.
All right, everybody.
It's going to be fun.
Take a listen and we'll be right back.
Chapter 23. Face each other and join your right hands, instructed the priest quietly. He then lifted a length of red silk above his head and addressed the congregation. "This cloth represents a promise bound in blood," said the priest. He wrapped the silk around their wrists 3 times. It poured from their hands and reached to the floor, where it pooled at their feet. The priest continued, "It's a symbol that binds their vows and seals the promises they have sworn to each other. May the star of love, the moon of health, and the sun of prosperity serve you faithfully until the day of transformation, when you shall leave this mundane, temporal world and become a glorious and eternal light in the vast and great celestial sea." The priest instructed them to release their hands, and the red silk fell into a puddle on the floor. From a pedestal, he picked up 2 golden bands and held them up for the congregation to see. "The rings!" he exclaimed. He handed the rings to the couple, who exchanged them in silence. "The matrimonial kiss will express to this beloved assembly your undying love and affection for each other." The couple kissed, and quiet rumblings of delighted expressions filtered through the approving congregation. "The marriage of Sir Bartlett of the House of Thayer and Princess Corina from the Royal House of Carlington is now sealed. May the Book of Satins guide them henceforth and forevermore." Antiphonal trumpets began a fanfare that echoed through the voluminous Grace of the Moon oratory. It was the largest satinary in Allaire, and it was designated as an oratory because it was home to the High Priest of Satins. The towering architectural wonder stood facing the main gates to Anza. The royal wedding procession made its way through the nave and exited onto the main steps. The couple descended and were ushered into a carriage that was waiting to take them along the processional route from the oratory to the castle. A grand royal reception had been planned at Castle Hill. The evening would conclude with an unprecedented display of fireworks. The entire city was adorned with yellow and black flags, banners, and bunting. Tens of thousands of Illyrians lined the boulevard. Bartlett's popularity had attracted a following of adoring young ladies, but most Illyrians were clamoring along the boulevard, hoping to catch a glimpse of Corina. She was known throughout the kingdom as the darling of Allaire. Expectant mothers prayed for the spirits to bless them with a ginger-haired child. The name Corina had quickly become the most popular name for a girl. Festival Hall at Castle Hill was soon teeming with the royal guests. Although Corvis was getting on in years, she had insisted on overseeing the wedding feast. It had taken her staff days to prepare. The decorations had been designed by a new popular Illyrian artist. Corina's favorite band, the Saddle Dogs, pumped their musical energy into the room. Beatrice and Alfred stood at the railing on the second level that overlooked the hall and soaked in the celebration. Corina and Bartlett were seated on a dais, enjoying their guests. The sun had set, and soon the throng would move outside to watch the fireworks. "Do you like the music?" Alfred shouted to Beatrice. "What?" quipped Beatrice. "I can't hear you." Alfred laughed. "I know what you mean. It's too loud and monotonous. We are beginning to show our age."
"Speak for yourself," she said, slapping Alfred's arm. "I'm only 57. Maybe I like this music after all," she teased.
Corina and Bartlett had moved to the dance floor, and it had emptied, leaving them to dance alone. Their guests cheered for them and were sending out a steady stream of Pictos and Cenobites. The kingdom was thrilled with every morsel that was pushed their way.
"She's a beautiful bride, isn't she?" Beatrice asked.
"She is," Alfred agreed, "and she's witty and smart and insightful. And she's certainly more mature at 19 than either of us were at her age." Alfred stopped. The crowd was pointing to an illumination that was swirling like a cloud and filtering in through the main entrance, gathering itself above the dance floor. It began to organize into a sphere several feet above Bartlett and Corina. The murmuring crowd stepped back. The band stopped playing and the room grew tense. At first, it was small, but it grew to be several feet in diameter. There was no outer shell, but it was perfectly round, as if a cloud or a mist of iridescent energy had coalesced into a tangible yet untouchable globe. Once it had completely assembled, a woman's face appeared inside of it. The face swam around the surface in the same distorted manner in which the elements inside of it seethed and churned. The room became silent, and the face in the sphere spoke.
"A little flower, a meadowlark, grew from a secret in the dark, when bloody drops fell to the ground, and promised words from lips were bound. One drank the cup to quench her thirst, and from the clouds the rain did burst. One watched it rain for several years. In time, her sunshine will appear. And when it does, there is a debt that must be paid, so don't forget. A meadowlark has but one voice. Someone here has but one choice."
The face disappeared, and the gaseous mass began dissipating into dozens of stringy wisps, moving like eels in every direction, seeking an exit at any open door or window. Slowly, murmurs rose from the crowd, followed by hushed conversations. The voice had been deliberate and emphatic. Nobody misunderstood what had been said. But nobody knew what the message meant. Nobody except Beatrice. Beatrice's heart dropped into her stomach. She had not seen or communicated with Calixta since she drank the potion at the well. Before Corina was born, her thoughts were consumed with ways to break her blood promise. But as time went on, she had become complacent and focused her attentions on Karina. In the months leading up to the wedding, the promise had niggled at her, but she had ignored it, half hoping that the agreement would simply fade away. Queen Beatrice addressed the crowd.
What royal celebration would be complete without a magical surprise? She asked with animated enthusiasm. Let's toast. Raise your glasses to the one voice of marriage, the one choice of eternal bond.
Everyone followed Queen Beatrice's lead. They cheered and drank. There were still many who were questioning the full message and its meaning, but the incident appeared to be over. Beatrice's quick thinking and enthusiastic demeanor had managed to return the atmosphere in the room back to a mood of joyous celebration. The band resumed playing, and the dance floor filled once again. Fireworks soon rocketed skyward and burst over Castle Hill, showering the night sky with a variety of spectacular sparkles and booms. Alarians from miles around watched in amazement. The royal wedding fireworks remained a topic of conversation for years to come.
A royal wedding. There has to be, in every wonderful book, a royal wedding. I can just see all of the beautiful dresses, gowns, and all the pageantry that's going on. But then, somebody spoils the wedding. There's always somebody that ruins the wedding.
Well, in this case...
It's usually a drunk cousin, but in this case...
A drunk cousin. We have an interloper, obviously. Calixta has arrived. Nobody knows what's transpired all those years before with the promise in the tunnel. And so that's kind of, I don't know, things, the plot thickens, I guess. This is where that happens. Yeah. I wonder if anybody reading that chapter or listening to that chapter, I wonder if they paid attention to one of the parallels that came from chapter, I believe chapter 2, if not chapter 3, when Lizzy went to the backyard to feed the birds.
Oh, yeah, I don't know. Feed the birds. We'll have to ask our readers to let us know.
We're trying to pull a lot of fun stuff into the story that happened a lot earlier, so I hope that you might have found that. And we're looking forward to giving you chapter 24, and we're going to do that. That'll be coming up soon, so stay tuned, follow along, and enjoy, everyone. Thank you for listening.
Bye.